every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So if I was going for 80s hair today, I would say I nailed it. So everybody who knows me knows that my hair turns out different every single day. Oh, sorry. Anyway, try not to be distracted by my bad hair. Today, we're going to talk about the fact that you are on a mission from God. Okay, every time I hear that, in my head, I hear Dan Aykroyd in the Blues Brothers saying, "We're on a mission from God."
We're on a mission from God.
Listen, you are. We are. We all are. And it's up to us to understand the mission, to find the mission, and then fulfill it. Okay, I talk about purpose all the time, but I want to kind of focus us in on it's a mission. If you think about your purpose as a mission, you're more likely to think about it from the standpoint of being time sensitive. Okay, because when you're on a mission, there's pressure, there's a time frame in which this thing has to get done. So let's think about it for today. I'm not trying to add additional pressure to your life, but if you've had the feeling that, it's really not all that important, I want you to maybe change your thinking on that just a little bit. So how do you find your mission? Okay, well, that is the $64,000 question, right? So seeking your mission from God is really a journey of self-discovery. It's a journey, a faith journey, really. It's believing in yourself, believing that you have worth and value. There's a thing that you were made to do and you are capable of doing it. You can see where there's a self-confidence that's involved. There's a belief in your worthiness that's involved. And I'm saying all that because I struggled with that. So if you happen to be somebody who struggles with that, I want you to suspend your disbelief for the moment. If you have an issue with thinking that you are important enough or worthy enough to have a mission, let that go. Please just go with me on this and believe that you do have a mission from God, okay? So embrace your talents, your passions. These are the tools that you will need in order to fulfill your mission. Okay. God wouldn't give you some mission to accomplish and then not give you the tools to do it. He's not cruel. He's not stupid. He's not forgetful. Everything, every talent that you have, every ability that you have, those things that you feel passionate about, they're there for a reason and they all go together. Okay. So we've talked about talents, passion, the things that grieve you, the ways that your brain works, the way that you see the world, all of that. This all comes together for your mission. Okay. So finding your mission is generally speaking a process. I would love it if we could just, snap our fingers and boom, we know exactly what it is. I wish I had some formula for letting you know what your particular mission from God is. I don't. I've met people who knew when they were little kids what they wanted to do. with their lives. Like they were so super clear about it. And sadly, I've known people who lived their entire lives and never knew, never really looked, but never knew that there was anything more to their lives than going about their day, eating, sleeping, waking up the next day, doing the exact same thing, eating, sleeping again, waking up the next day. I don't know if that's really living. The people I know who lived really without any purpose, without faith, without believing that they had a mission, weren't very happy people. So for most of us, finding our mission is a process. It requires patience. It requires prayer. It requires action on our part. It always requires action on our part. It's important to connect with other people as well and not be afraid to say to a trusted person, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to be doing with my life. I care about this. I can do this well. I'm not sure how it all fits together. And you know, sometimes other people are able to see things about us that we can't see. We all have blind spots. And other people can very often see good in us that we don't even realize is there. And it's because the things that you do really well, really effortlessly, it's just part of who you are. We tend to think that everybody's like that. Everybody does that. Everybody knows that. No, they don't. They don't. So talk to people around you, people that you're close to, people who know you well, and ask them, what did they think that you're good at? Think about what people come to you for. Do people come to you for advice? If so, on what? What kinds of things? Those are super good clues about what your mission from God may be. You want to stay connected with people. In fact, you know, it might not be a bad idea if you are really serious about moving forward on your mission from God. To put together what I would call a mastermind group. This is a group of people who are committed to each other, committed to helping one another live out their purpose, create successful lives for themselves. We don't typically do that by ourselves. It's much better in community, in healthy relationships with good people who genuinely care about you and about your life, about fulfilling your purpose, about being successful. And when I say successful, I'm talking about living one's purpose. People who care about your joy and your peace. If you choose to surround yourself with these folks, give them permission to be honest with you. Because not only do our people, our tribe, see good in us, they can also see often where we're holding ourselves back, where we're sabotaging ourselves, where we are short-circuiting, making dumb decisions. I'm thinking about somebody that I knew a long time ago, incredibly successful businesswoman, so smart, beautiful, educated, had everything going for her. Her personal life, on the other hand, was a complete disaster. And no one would say anything to her because she was large and in charge at work and in her life. And it's sad because she didn't have happiness. She didn't have peace. She didn't have even one single person close to her who she could really trust on a personal level. And I think it had a great deal to do with not giving people permission to really speak the truth and to hold a mirror up to her. You want people in your life who will tell you that you have spinach in your teeth or your zipper's down or, you know, whatever. I say to all my friends, don't let me walk around and be just completely wrong, you know, dressed wrong, hair wrong. Well, hair's wrong, you know, a lot. There's not a lot I can do about that. I'm just not talented that way. But you get my point. Now, once you have one person in your life that you can really trust, and you're embracing all the aspects of who you are, your character traits, your personality traits, your talents, the things that you know how to do, your passions, your perspective, and you decide that you are okay, better than okay, that you are up for the mission. And you have people around you, or at least one person around you, who's willing to cheer you on. And maybe you're going to do that same thing for them. Now, this is the second phase. Now you want to find a problem. Identify a problem that needs to be solved. It can be a problem in your own life. It can be a problem in society. It can be a problem in your community, in your neighborhood. It can be a problem that you see someone else having. Innovation is, I don't want to say always, I could be wrong about this, but I think innovation is almost always part of our mission, our God-given mission. Okay, so here's what I mean by that. Innovation involves creativity. God says in his word that we were created in his image. Now, does that mean that, you know, God has two eyes and one nose and a mouth and ears on the side of the head? I don't know. But what I do know is that the Bible says that God created the world and everything in it. So I think, okay, God is our creator, is creative. If he made us in his image, then we're creative. We're the only species on earth, really, that can have a thought in our mind and actually make that thought be a reality. Think about that. If you're sitting in a chair or sofa or laying in a bed, whatever you do, wherever you are, somebody somewhere thought up the design for that chair, that sofa, that bed. It was an idea in someone's mind before they drew it on a piece of paper or wrote it out, before somebody put a nail in a piece of wood, before somebody created that, it was an idea. You have the ability to create. You are creative. That creativity that you have can be the invention of a new product. It can be the creation of a service. It can be the establishment of a company or a nonprofit organization that exists to serve others. inventions and innovation arise from the desire to solve specific challenges that make people's lives better. And, you know, it doesn't have to be, you know, Thomas Edison inventing the light bulb. I mean, that changed our culture, changed society. It launched so many changes, right? Alexander Graham Bell, building on an existing invention, a thing that already existed, he made some minor tweaks to it and invented the telephone. So you can see where I'm going with this. When you think about, okay, let's take the telephone, for example. When you think about life before the telephone, right? When you had to, you know, send a letter through the Pony Express or actually go see somebody face to face in order to have a conversation with them. And all of a sudden, here comes this invention where something that almost seems, you know, back then, think of how they thought of it. Is it supernatural? Is it magic? Is it a big lie? Is it, you know, and here we are. And now here we are with the ability to talk to people without cords, without phone lines. It's just in the air. I don't know. I can't explain it. It's, you know, it's beyond me. But when we think about the ability that we have now to communicate because somebody decided to use their creativity, it's really pretty amazing. You have that in you. Identify a problem, a need, a challenge. Okay, then you want to research the problem, study the issues, try to understand what has already been done, what's been tried, if anything, what are the challenges, what types of things would you have to overcome? Could you try something and see if it works? Who else can you involve in that process? If you bring people together, maybe who are also concerned, and brainstorm potential solutions, sometimes having the right people in the room and giving them permission to challenge you can spark other ideas that are better than the original ideas that were being discussed. I have a friend who was the global CEO of an international, worldwide company, who said that he challenged the people in his organization to share their opposition freely. He said that one of the keys to his success was spirited debate, giving people permission to challenge everything. He said that spirited debate makes everybody smarter. That's how we get smarter. So bring people together to talk about the issues, to get their perspective. And don't shut people down when they try to shut down an idea. Hear them out. It might sound like the person is a downer, but they may very well save you a lot of time and trouble in investing in something that you know, isn't going to work. Better to know that something's not going to work before you've put, you know, 9 months worth of work into it. As you're doing your research on whatever it is that you want to fix, think about those existing solutions, the existing programs that are out there, ideas that are out there. Maybe like Alexander Graham Bell, who, you know, tweaked something and voila, we have the phone. Think about existing ideas. A lot of innovation comes from improvement or adaptations to existing products or ideas. So look for ways to build on what already exists. Don't be afraid to, you know, I always say, instead of building a set of tracks and building a train and starting, don't be afraid to jump on a train that's already barreling down the tracks. Okay. Another really important thing, don't be afraid to collaborate. So many people think that their mission from God, their purpose, their life is something that they have to do. They have to figure it out on their own. And okay, you know, some people work better alone, but there's a tremendous amount of benefit in a willingness to collaborate with others, cooperate with others. And some of that benefit looks an awful lot like not duplicating efforts. If somebody else is doing something and they do it really, really well, why would you want to compete with them? Pick a thing that's not being done or not being done well and improve on it. And then instead of this other person or this other organization being a competitor to you, you can cooperate. You can do more. Go farther. When you lock arms with other people. Test out your ideas. So after you've sorted through all the different problems and challenges and potential ideas, it's time to test it. You could do a pilot program. Maybe you can cooperate or collaborate with your local city, county, state, maybe with nonprofits or other businesses in the area, and just do a pilot program and see what works. If you do something like that, you know, from a business perspective, I want to share with you, make sure that you have baseline measurements as much as you possibly can for whatever it is that you're trying to address, okay? So, for example, something that I'm working on right now is a program to prevent child trafficking in Las Vegas. Las Vegas is a worldwide destination for child trafficking. So the first thing that I tried to do was find out, okay, who in this area is trying to do something about this problem? So study the issues, right? And then look around to see, okay, so what assets do we have in this area? Do we have people who care about this issue, care deeply about this issue, but just aren't maybe sure what to do, what they can do? Bringing people together and just throwing out ideas, brainstorming about what can we do? What proven programs are there throughout the United States or promising practices throughout the United States that we could bring in and replicate instead of starting from scratch? So you get the idea. And now what we're doing, we're in the process. We've done those pieces. Now we're in the process of raising money to actually launch the pilot program. We will have baseline measurements, launch our pilot program, and measure at 3, 6, 9, 12 month intervals to see if, you know, if it's working. And a very important part of this is, let's not be afraid to really ask the question and evaluate the numbers. Let's not get our egos all woven in and tangled up with this so that we're not willing to see the truth. Because if we're If we're on a mission from God to do something good, what we don't want to be doing is running full force in the wrong direction, putting all of our time and energy and treasure into maybe this thing right here, which isn't terribly effective, when if we just made some, if we looked at the data, saw what's working, what's not, and then make some adjustments, could do so much more, help so many more people. In our case, save kids from being lured in to trafficking, right? So it's very important to measure your effectiveness. Don't get so set on it has to be this way that your ego is going to get bruised if anything changes. You don't have to have all the answers. Nobody expects you on your mission from God or anybody else's mission from God to have all the answers. It is important to stay in prayer, ask for direction, ask God to open up doors that you can't open, ask Him to give you favor and to give you the right words in the right order at the right time with the right people, and to prepare their hearts to hear what you have to say, what you want to share, and also to prepare your heart and your ears to really hear what other people have to say without getting offended, without taking it personally. Because see, all of this, yes, it's your mission, but it's not about you. It's always about helping someone else. It's always about the greater good. And when you're doing that, it splashes back up on you. It does help you. It does improve your life. It does move you right straight into the sweet middle of God's purpose for your life. And that's where the peace and the joy and all the good things are found. That's where you want to be. The last thing I want to talk to you about is, in this whole train, don't be discouraged by setbacks or failures. The things that we think are setbacks, the things that we feel like are failures, are learning opportunities. This is how we figure out what's working and what's not working. They can be stumbling blocks. But if you look at it from the perspective of, okay, I would rather know sooner than later if something's not going to work, and then figure something else out. Whatever the obstacles are, go over them, tunnel under them, go around them, blast through them, but don't stop. If the thing that you attempt to do requires funding, explore all the avenues for the funding of your product, your service, your business. You can seek funding. You can seek commercialization, you know, selling your product. And there's never been a better time to do that. Really, no matter what it is that you're, whatever innovation or invention that you may come up with, there's never been a better time to do that because of the internet. We can talk to millions of people, and it costs little or nothing to be able to do that. And if you have an innovation or an invention, it's going to help people, that might save a life, that is meaningful and positive, and you communicate it effectively to others, there will be others who come alongside of you and say, you know what? I believe in what you're doing. I want to help you. And you'll get your funding. You'll get support. You'll get people who jump in the boat and start rowing with you. And don't worry about the people who don't, because your particular mission is not for everybody. Everybody has their own thing. So don't be offended when your best friend is not on board. Okay, that person has something else that he or she's supposed to do. Don't worry about it. Understand that when you figure out what your mission from God is, okay, you have to be persistent. You have to be tenacious. You have to refuse to give up. Lots of the innovations have taken years to develop. I read somewhere where Thomas Edison tried thousands of times to create that very first incandescent light bulb. Think about that. That's thousands of failures. Imagine spending hours and hours and hours, days, weeks, months, years of your life and working all day and coming in and flopping down in the chair knowing that you failed. Didn't work today. Didn't happen today. But if you keep trying, keep communicating your mission, your objective to others, keep evaluating the data, making adjustments, trying again, you will succeed because it's your mission from God. And He has all the answers. He has all the power. He has all the provision. He has everything that you need. So that's it for today. I hope that you find your mission and that you throw yourself into it with reckless abandon and go out and create a solution for a problem or a challenge that will improve the lives of others. And yours as well. See you next time.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.